The aim of war is not to reach definite lines, but to annihilate the enemy physically. It is by these means that we shall obtain the vital living space that we need. Who today still speaks of the massacre of the Armenians? Adolf Hitler, 1939. During World War I, the Ottoman Empire accused the Armenian minority of collaborating with the Russians. The Armenians were shot and killed or marched at gunpoint across arid landscapes without food or water. By war's end, 1 million Armenians were dead. The Allied forces attempted to convict those responsible. On May 24, 1915, England, France, and Russia charged another nation for the first time of crimes against humanity. However, by the time a court was established and those responsible convicted, many of the guilty had found asylum in other countries. In 1921, Raphael Lemkin, a 21-year-old Polish Jew studying at the University of Lvov, learned of the Armenian massacre. Intrigued, he questioned one of his professors as to why the Ottoman leaders had not been held responsible. His teacher answered, "Consider the case of a farmer who owns a flock of chickens. He kills them, and this is his business. If you interfere, you are trespassing." Lemkin was appalled by this assessment and did not believe that state sovereignty gave a country a right to wipe out a minority. In 1933, Lemkin, now a lawyer, presented a bill to the International Criminal Law Conference in Madrid that would ban acts of extermination directed against ethnic, religious, or social collectivities. He split the crime into two parts: barbarism, the harming of an individual in order to harm a group, and vandalism, referring to the destruction of a culture of a group. Lemkin feared Nazi aggression and believed the bill would help curb the threat to the Jews of Germany and Europe. However, Lemkin's proposal received little support at the conference. The representatives were skeptical about the threat of mass murder posed by Nazi Germany. The plan was put aside. Lemkin persisted, and in the next few years, he presented his proposal at conferences across Europe.
On September 1st, 1939, Germany invaded Poland, and Lemkin fled into the forest. There he joined a community of nomads, wandering the forest with hundreds of other Poles. In the chaos, Lemkin was shot in the leg. He managed to escape Poland and made it to neutral Sweden in February of 1940. From there, he secured an appointment to teach international law at Duke University. Lemkin continued his crusade in the United States. He warned the government that the Nazis were not only fighting against the rest of Europe, but were also seeking to exterminate European Jews. Realizing that he was gaining little ground, Lemkin decided he needed to distinguish race murder from other war crimes. Winston Churchill's August 1941 BBC address captures this sentiment.
"There has never been methodical, merciless butchery on such a scale. We are in the presence of a crime without a name."
Lemkin was determined to give the crime a name. In his 1944 book, Axis Rule in Occupied Europe, genocide appeared in print for the first time. Genocide comes from the ancient Greek genos, meaning race or tribe, and the Latin side, meaning killing. Genocide is directed against a national group as an entity, and the actions involved are directed against individuals, not in their individual capacity, but as members of the national group. The Nazi death camps were discovered as the Allies moved across Europe to eventual victory in May 1945. Lemkin's fears and warnings had come true. The Germans had exterminated nearly 6 million Jews and 5 million others. The victorious Allies established an international military tribunal in Nuremberg, Germany, in response to the Nazi atrocities. The tribunal charged the perpetrators with crimes against humanity. In May 1946, Lemkin went to Nuremberg to lobby for the inclusion of genocide into the charter of the military tribunal. Though the charter was finalized before it could be included, he hoped that the prosecution's use of the word genocide would help to popularize the new term. The Nuremberg trials ended, and while 19 were found guilty of crimes against humanity, there was not a single mention of genocide. While in Nuremberg, Lemkin met with his brother Elias, who informed him that they were the last living members of their family. 49 other family members, including Lemkin's mother and father, were victims of the Holocaust. His terrible loss made him more determined than ever.